Welcome into episode 49 of the Sources Say podcast, your go-to Kentucky basketball and recruiting podcast on the growing KSR podcast network. I'm your host, Jack Pilgrim of Kentucky Sports Radio. And today I'm happy to be joined once again by Travis Graff and David Sisk of Cats Illustrated. Travis, what's going on, brother?
Doing good. Just got back from my second vacation in 3 weeks. So it's a tough life. And you just got back from Jamaica, right? How was that?
I did. Oh man, it was so awesome. I wish I never came back, but then I wouldn't be able to produce this beautiful show and let the fans get what they deserve. So I'm taking one for the team by coming back and putting forth this beautiful show for you guys. David, what's going on?
Baby Pilgrim coming April 2021.
let's not root for that. That's a no-go right now. David, what's up?
And for all the poor people like me out there that can't afford to go on vacations, I'm here for you. I am your voice.
You should start taking over this show when Travis starts taking his 36 vacations a year and I'm doing my own thing. This could be the David Sisk show. It's only David Sisk takes.
I want to know how many people that you guys have already given COVID to. You know, that's what happens. Everybody goes to the beach and they come back and give it to everybody else.
Well, Jamaica only has 700 confirmed cases ever. Only 10 deaths since it all started. I'm safer in Jamaica than I am going to the grocery store in Kentucky. So
that's an argument to stay in Jamaica.
Exactly. That's what I said.
In North Carolina, we weren't in within probably 50 yards of any people on the beach, and we stayed up in the beach house the whole time, didn't go out for dinner.
I had no clue you went. Where did you go? Wrightsville Beach or the Outer Banks? I had no clue.
I normally go to Outer Banks, but my cousin just moved to Oak Island, so we went down there this year.
Yeah, my beach in Jamaica, there are only, I think, 150 people on the entire resort all week long. So the resort was completely empty. There were no lines to get drinks, no lines to get food. No, I mean, it was completely empty from start to finish. It was, if you're going to travel during a pandemic, that's definitely the way to do it. I promise you. It was amazing, man. I'm very excited to get back when all this stuff is over and I have more money in my bank account. That would just be absolutely lovely. All right. Well, today we have a couple of fun things, a couple, you know, more serious recruiting updates, a bunch of new stuff for you guys. We're going to start the show getting caught up on a couple new recruiting names, a couple high profile guys. Then we're going to go through and we're going to have a little debate on a few topics. We're going to go through the 2021-2022 roster, kind of go through the entire thing and see who we think's Kentucky's going to return for next year, who's going to sign, there aren't going to be any surprises, any fun stuff like that. Then we're going to end the show by talking about the big controversial article that Sam Vecchini of The Athletic put out. I mean, that was basically the bulk of today's news. Was he put out an article of a bunch of anonymous college coaches talking trash about Kentucky's, I guess, the 2019-20 roster guys, the draft hopefuls for this upcoming draft class. A bunch of college coaches talk trash about a bunch of the UK guys, made headlines. So we're going to talk about that. And then at the end, we'll answer a couple questions from fans about recruiting and the landscape moving forward, all that stuff. So without further ado, let's jump into a few of the biggest recruiting updates over the last week or two-ish since we last talked. We'll start with Jaden Bradley. We had him on our show, 2022 five-star guard, consensus top 10 player in the class of 2022. Kentucky sets up a Zoom call with him last week, I believe. There's a lot of speculation that an offer was going to be coming. That didn't happen. People thought it was coming because Sky Clark got his offer the week prior. So people thought UK was going one by one, that Jaden Bradley's going to be the next school up. That didn't happen. Travis, you've been in contact with Jaden's dad following all that. Tell us what you know about how that conversation went and why an offer was not extended.
So basically, they know an offer is going to come eventually. They don't know when it's going to come. They haven't been like pressuring Kentucky into feeling like they need to offer. And the thing that sets Kentucky apart is they haven't offered, but they're still possibly in the driver's seat in this recruitment, because his dad told me that relationships are the key for the Bradley family. And just because you have an offer don't mean that you have better relationships with teams that don't offer you. And he said that there are a lot of schools who talk to families they offered. There are a lot of schools who don't talk to families they offered as much as we communicate with Kentucky. He's really high with Kentucky, Joel Justice, Calipari constantly in lines of communication with them. There's no hard feelings about no offer. They know what's up. They know where they stand. They know that one's probably going to come at some point. I would put a lot of money on that. And he's definitely one of their top targets in 2022, if not the top target, if Scott Clark was to reclass. And yeah, so I wouldn't put too much stock into them not having an offer at this time.
David, what do you think? Do you think it means more that Sky Clark earned an offer as early as he did? Do you think it's more telling that his side of things, that he was the first to get an offer without Calipari seeing in person, with all this AAU stuff being canceled and postponed and all that? Do you think that it's more indicative of Sky Clark being Sky Clark and his thoughts on Kentucky? How do you think that kind of relates to the Jaden Bradley recruitment and Kentucky not offering him yet?
You know, you used the word speculation, and that's exactly what everything is, and that's what I would be doing right now. And I'll be honest, I'm kind of nervous about answering something like that, because if as many people that watch this, I don't want there to be an idea that one player is more important to coaches than the other, and then that goes out and it gets back to, not to say that any of us three have an influence enough to impact a recruitment, but I certainly wouldn't want to say anything to hurt one, because, and the reason I say that, I don't know that I've got an answer. And there's so many ways you could go. I mean, you bring up a great point. I think it's obvious that Kentucky and Sky is a different type of recruitment, because I kind of got the idea once the offer came out that Sky would make that decision for the Cats pretty quickly. I really did, and I think he will. Jaden, I don't know as much about on that front, but I don't know if that's got something to do with it, where it's like, hey, we know if we offer Sky – and he's going to – we could get him pretty quickly. That's one thing. I don't know, with Kennedy Chandler still in the mix in there, how that affects everything. And just the whole dynamic of just what the coaches are thinking along with a player. I'll admit it, I thought that when Jaden Bradley, when they were going to meet – and I think I'd said so much on Twitter. I'm not going to lie about it. I thought an offer was going to come. I don't know about you two, but I did. There's a lot, man. You could write a book about kind of the things going on. Does Devin Eskew come back? I mean, there's there's a lot of layers to that cake.
Well, see, the thing, too, that people forget is the Bradley family and the Clark family are really, really, really close. So there's no sour grapes there about who has offer, who doesn't. They're both rooting for each other. They've talked about playing with each other before. And here's the thing. Like, I've talked to Bradley and his dad. Like, I talk to them probably once a week. And really phenomenal family, really great group of guys. And they always say that relationships is the biggest key to winning over Jaden and that family. And then the rest of the text that – I read a part of it a minute ago. The rest of the text that he sent me today – said, because I asked him, I said, do you think UK would offer you all like they did Sky without seeing you in person? He said, I think there's always a chance. Our family puts more stock in relationship. Our relationship with Kentucky is awesome. We talk about family, basketball, and the opportunity to become a great steward in multiple areas. So Kentucky's pitch, every time I talk to Nate, who is Jaden's dad, he just talks about how phenomenal the relationships are with the Kentucky coaching staff. Coach Justice has done a fantastic job of putting the Cats in a great situation moving forward as the recruitment starts to hit the home stretch over the next year or so. Kentucky has as good of a chance as anybody. I think North Carolina's right there. There's some other schools. G League might be an option, but they're definitely going to do their due diligence, and they're not in any hurry to make a decision. So.
Hey, I'll go back quickly to something that we've talked about before that I forgot to say a while ago. How important is an offer from Kentucky in the whole scenario of things? We've talked about other players. Greg Brown, I remember his dad was the first one to tell me, he says, do we have an offer? And Coach Cal was just like, well, if you want to, you know, if that's what you want to say publicly, yeah, we want you to be here. If it takes an offer, then yeah, you've got one. If not, you know, that's up to you. But if we're going to spend all this time recruiting you, and I think his message was, if we're going to spend time on a Zoom call or at that time a conference call with you, our host staff, with your family, then it's obvious that we want you to be a Kentucky Wildcat. So, you know, that may be some of it in this situation too.
Yeah, I think the last time I talked to somebody really close to, you know, the recruiting scene on Kentucky and kind of them setting up the big board and who they're going to, you know, approach. Basically, the question was, what's next for you guys? How are you going to approach this moving forward? And it was very apparent that 2021 was their biggest concern right now. They wanted to make sure that they know that they don't have many offers on the table right now, and they know that needs to improve. And I think with Scott, added, you know, that kind of prioritized him over some of the other guards in the class because they know where they stand with Sky right now, and they know that he's strongly considered moving to 2021. He told us on our show last week that he's taking both junior and senior year classes and, you know, in the classroom next year to prepare for a potential jump to 2021. So when you have a player, you know, same thing with Brandon Huntley Hatfield, when you have a guy that is telling you behind the scenes, yeah, this is something I'm really strongly considering, you should probably be recruiting me for both years, not just 2022. So when that kind of situation presents itself, you kind of prioritize them no matter what, because you're going to need them for next year, not the year after necessarily. Jaden Bradley, he came on our show. He said that he's, you know, kind of sort of thinking about a reclass up to 2021, but didn't necessarily say that that was his biggest priority. He was, you know, kind of saying he's going to take it one step at a time. Sky was definitely more forward and saying, yeah, this is definitely a serious thing. This is definitely something I'm going to be strongly considering moving forward. So I think that in itself, I don't think there's, you know, on Kentucky side of things, I don't think they look at those two players and think of them as, you know, different talents or they favor one kid over the other. I think it's, one has just simply come forward and saying, I'm ready to come potentially next year as opposed to 2 years from now. And I think that, you know, when it comes to timing, they just need to make sure that that he knows that he has an offer waiting for him if he does decide to do that.
That's a big thing I think they moved in on Scout for, is because, I mean, you look at the roster this year, well, it's hard to predict who all is ever going to come back at Kentucky. Devin Askew could be one and done for all I know, and I never thought that ever. So, but Kentucky's going to lose Davion Mintz. They're going to lose Brandon Boston. They're going to lose Terrence Clark, unless something goes tragically, tragically wrong with one of those guys. They'll lose all three of them. And then if you get Sky that's leaning, like, strongly, like you said, toward a reclassification, and UK's not in the thick of things with many 2021 guards outside of Jaden Bradley at this time, I mean, it's a –
Jaden Hardy.
What did I say? Jaden Bradley?
Bradley, yeah.
Yeah, Jaden Hardy. Either way. Too many Jadens. Yeah.
Too many Jadens.
Yeah. But, yeah, so they're in the thick of things with Jaden Hardy. I think UK is in a good position with him. But if, let's say, they miss out on him and then you don't get any reclasses, like, might as well go in on the guy that's strongly considering it.
Yeah. I'm all in. You kind of brought up one of our biggest topics that we're going to talk about just here in a bit. Let's run through just a couple other recruiting things that popped up over the last couple of weeks. Next one, there's another name that kind of popped up out of the blue. Literally, I was sitting in a beach chair with the Jamaican ocean in front of me. I'm just relaxing. I have a drink in my hand. It's just the most peaceful thing. It was actually my birthday, and I get a text. Hey, brother, happy birthday. I hope you're having a fun honeymoon. It looks like you're having a good time. By the way, there's another name that you need to keep a close eye on. His name's Sage Tolentino. He's a Hawaiian kid. class of 2022, 7'1", 16 years old. And the text I got said, some of the best footwork I've seen from a kid his age, or something along those lines. And he said, Auburn is on him heavy, but Kentucky is maintaining regular contact with him, specifically Kenny Payne. And I'm like, well, I'm supposed to be unplugged this week, but I guess I'll address this. I'll just send, you know, copy and paste the text and send it into a tweet. Took 2 seconds, but anyway, I sent it off immediately, and I was like, man, I probably should do a little bit more research on this kid before just randomly putting out, hey, Kentucky's in consistent contact with this kid. You know, this is a big deal. Travis, you talked to Sage not long afterward. I talked to him the same day. And then I also got a text from somebody close to Kentucky to kind of, you know, verify what's going on and all that. And it's not as cut and dry as this individual kind of led on to believe. It's definitely more of a complex, definitely initial stage of any type of recruitment whatsoever. So, Travis, tell your side of this, and I'll counter with what I heard.
Yeah, so basically I heard that Kentucky has made contact, but they're not nearly in consistent contact. Like, whoever said that, like, it's not an everyday thing. It's a here and there thing. And most of the time they don't even talk to him. And so my thing is, like, you watch the film. I think he's a more fluid, probably higher ceiling Kai Soto. Wouldn't fit Kentucky's game. I think he'd be a better fit than Kai Soto. But I think that just watching the tape, I don't think he's a UK guy. And then whenever I heard the best footwork ever line, I was like, this guy's got to be from Kentucky that said this, because Kentucky never has, like, really good bigs at all. And yeah, this guy's working out in Kentucky. He might look like Kareem compared to people that come through here. But I definitely think it was probably a little bit of overhype, like, hey, I got this, like, good player. But, I mean, he plays for the Skill Factory, 2022. Yeah. And so they always turn out good players. That's where Kai Soto played. And that's where Bruce Thornton plays, a couple other top players. And, yeah, so, I mean, name to watch out for sure, but I don't see UK being a big player in his recruitment at this point.
So when somebody close to UK reached out to me, they kind of said, so where'd you hear this info from for the Sage Tolentino kid? I told them, and it was like a, well, let's just kind of take a step back. Kind of basically in the most simple terms, yes, UK is interested in this kid. They are technically recruiting him, but they said the text I got said that Kenny Payne was in daily contact with him. And they said, just so you know, Kenny Payne doesn't talk to anybody daily. Like, you could be the number one player in the country, and that's just not his job. Joel Justice talks to guys daily. Tony Barbie does. Kenny Payne has that next, you know, he doesn't have to. He's kind of the OG at Kentucky. He doesn't have to be as much of a – so when that daily text kind of came through, it was like, okay, that a little bit of an overhype there, so let's not go too far. And then said that Kenny talks to – it's Kai Soto's guardian or handler, however you want to say it. It's the same guy, so – him talking, Kenny Payne talking to said handler on a regular occasion doesn't necessarily mean Kenny is reaching out to Sage Tolentino daily. Like, they can be mutually, like, they're not mutually exclusive. Just because he's talking to the handler about just basketball, just talking, you know, talking sports, doesn't necessarily mean he is actively reaching out to this kid on a regular basis for him to come to Kentucky. So it was definitely one of those things where it was like, okay, yeah, he's a name to keep an eye on, but not one to expect any legitimate movement from especially in the near future. He is working out in Kentucky right now. He's up at Griffin Elite in Northern Kentucky, same place Dante Allen works out, same place a couple other familiar names have been working out recently. So he's in good hands up there. Kai Soto's been up there. That's where that initial contact was made in the first place. But yeah, this is definitely something that we should be, you know, keeping tabs on every once in a while, but definitely not something for Kentucky fans to go crazy over. David, I was wondering, did you see any film on this kid? Have you done any research on him at all? Sage Tolentino.
Pulp Fiction was great. And you know, I was looking at his movies, and man, I mean, you take some of the ones that he's done lately, and man, they made a lot more. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood made like $160 million more than Pulp Fiction. And so I think a lot of his movies are overrated and late, and his film early was good, but what I've seen it late, he's just, I think he's a little
I think I'm the only one in the United States that's never seen Pulp Fiction. I think Sage, I've heard Sage did a good job on it, but I mean, at this point, the NCAA is going to probably have to check in and see.
Hey, and he had
benefits.
He had some, man, when you've got Samuel Jackson, and you've got Bruce Willis, and you've got those guys, and you can absolutely just control the egos on that set. That said a lot to me. So, you know, Kenny Payne's got a hard eye for, he's a hard critic. If he's not impressed with that.
He has the best footwork some people have seen. He's got the highest IQ David Sisk has ever seen. So, I mean, complete basketball player. Might be Kareem at this point.
You guys are both idiots. If you guys aren't following along, he's making a funny joke about
Quentin Tarantino. By the way, Sage Tarantino was born in Knoxville, so that's not a good sign.
There you go. Well, this is, oh, geez, this is off the rails, and I kind of like it. It's you know, at this point, whatever.
At this point in time where we're at in society, I mean, not everything's going to be I'll take a little bit of slapstick humor here and there.
I love it. Okay, a guy that I don't think has any close name relations to any famous directors or actors or writers, or I don't think so. It'd be really tough to find a comparison here. Musa Cisse commits to Memphis. I'm pretty certain there's no connections there. But today, the top 10 prospect in class of 2021. What did he just reclassify? Yeah, he reclassified to 2020. He just announced that he's committing to Memphis over LSU, Kentucky, Florida State, Georgia, Georgetown, a whole host of schools. Arguably the top shot blocker in high school basketball right now. Don't really care about how his recruitment unfolded. It was Memphis for the longest time when Penny Hardaway helped him move from New York to Memphis, which don't know how that's even, you know, that might be something that pops up at a later date. We'll see about that. For a little while, other schools pop in. Kentucky pops in. Florida State kind of becomes a dark horse favorite. And then LSU kind of overtakes all of them as the overwhelming favorite. And then here in the last 3 weeks or so, Memphis again overtakes LSU as the clear favorite. Bunch of crystal balls, bunch of future casts in favor of Penny Hardaway and the Tigers. And then today he makes it official. So I don't really care about how the recruitment unfolded and all. On Twitter and saying LSU is about to get hit hard by the NCAA the day that he was going to commit to LSU the first time. Do you think the ESPN legendary commentator single-handedly changed the momentum in that recruitment, Travis?
No. I think there's so many moving parts behind the scenes that in that recruitment. I think he was definitely 100% on board with LSU there for a little bit, but I don't – after I knew he wasn't – I knew Kentucky wasn't going to be an option for a while just because they had different interests, him and the Kentucky program. And whenever I found out that he was really not considering Kentucky strongly, I just kind of moved on from that recruitment. Didn't really ask too many questions, but I think that I think he's gonna be a fantastic fit at Memphis. He best shot blocker probably out of high school since Nerlens Noel. Freak athlete, gonna be a terrific rim runner as well. I mean, Memphis probably has their most well-rounded team, and everybody's been crapping on Penny the past year or so, and If Jalen Green would have went to college, he would have been at Memphis too. So that team would have been absolutely stacked next year. And that, I mean, Penny still has to prove that he can coach at this level. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt for the first 2 years because first year he inherited a crap roster. Second year, they would have been a top 10, 15 team had Wiseman not just sat out. So, but, I mean, I don't think that Memphis is going to be a huge threat, but I think that they're going to be a much improved program next year. And then Cissé is going to be a huge part of that.
David, am I overthinking the big conspiracy theory that Dick, by Dick putting that out, it kind of put more pressure on, oh, LSU equals paying players. Musa Cisse can't be in connection with that. Him back away from the table and go a different direction. Am I overthinking that or do you agree with me?
It didn't hurt. I think if Will Wade wanted to file a class action lawsuit, his lawyers got up and said, hey, Musa Cisse is scheduled to commit on such and such date. B, Dick Vitale comes and says that LSU's getting ready to get slammed by the NCAA. And C, he puts his date off. And D, he commits to Memphis. You know, there's a paper trail there. So, you know, whether it had an impact or not, you know, it certainly has kind of a look like that. But, you know, we just kind of felt, a lot of us, when Musa Cisse went to Memphis and moved there from Brooklyn and went to Lausanne, that, he's going to Memphis. And, you know, I thought it was kind of weird the way it broke from there, like for many months. There was just no buzz on Memphis and him. And you know, there was one thing we thought when Penny got to Memphis, he's going to lock that city down. And you look, he had probably the top guard in 2020 out of the city go to Ole Miss. You know, it looks like Kendi Chandler is going to go to Tennessee. Cisse was going to LSU. And I'm like, if you're at the University of Memphis and you have trouble recruiting in that town and you're a legendary figure there, you know, that's caused us some problems. But I'll say one more thing. It's funny that what Travis was talking about, and probably something we've not thought or really talked about much, but which coach has really got a break with COVID coming up in March and canceling the postseason? Because if you look at the teams, like Memphis wasn't going to get in. Tennessee wasn't going to get in. A lot of people look at the Tennessee team from 2 years ago and not the Tennessee team last year. But, you know, there were a lot of, for whatever reason, we think are really strong programs that didn't that wouldn't have gotten into the NCAA tournament. And I think they really caught a break because for whatever reason, people don't really look at them in that light.
Yeah. I think this is going to be a big year for Penny Hardaway and the Memphis team. I mean, if DeAndre Williams gets eligible, if Nolly gets eligible down there, I mean, they very well could have a top 15, top 20 level team next year. Really, really impressive group from top to bottom. And I'm not a Memphis fan in the slightest, not a big fan of Penny Hardaway in the slightest. So, you know, I'll tip my cap to what they're doing right now. And you know, you just got to give them credit. They got crapped on for a pretty long time about not being able to land anybody in this recruiting class and missing out on grad transfer after grad transfer. And it seems like things are unfolding in their favor for sure, especially if both those transfers get eligible next year. They're going to have a pretty solid squad. Definitely something to keep an eye on. Moving on to other guys that just have a Kentucky hat on the table to be a hat on the table. Jonathan Kuminga is set to announce his decision tomorrow, where I think the general consensus is that he's going to A, reclass officially to 2020, and he's going to officially go pro. Travis, are you feeling anything different other than the pro route? I mean, we're not going to go into this too in depth, but any last second thoughts on Kuminga's recruitment before he makes it official tomorrow?
No, my biggest question is whether he's going to go – which pro route he's going to take, either the G League where you get to live domestically but make less money but you're living in Cali with other top prospects and you're constantly under the eyes of NBA scouts, or you can go to, like, Australia, the NBL, and make more money. Is it tax-exempt over there? I can't remember.
Yeah, I think if you go internationally. I know if you go to Europe, play internationally, you're tax exempt. So
it could be. Even if he's not, he's going to be making – even if it's not tax exempt, he would be making much more money overseas, he'd probably make $1 million or so.
But the question is, would he be able to afford a vacation to Jamaica or three beach trips and four weekends?
Well, see, that's why I think he should go to the NBL, because he'd have more money and then he could do both. Money's kind of – you're going to be scrounging up pennies by the end of your G League contract, so.
Or if he's living in California, he's already physically living a vacation life, so he's not necessarily going to need to pay for it because he's already going to be doing it. So, bam, folks, there's your counter.
Let me tell you what's going to happen on this show. They're going to cut me loose here in about, you know, maybe sooner rather than later, but they're going to cut me loose. And you're going to end up with Kuminga on here and Robin Leach. Of course, I had to think of somebody old because I don't know who the young people are that do the travel shows. But it's going to be Jack and Travis and Kuminga and Robin Leach. And they're doing like Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous 2020, you know, travel show.
Island Life with Jack, Travis, John, and Robin Leach, or whoever you're referring to. We're young people. We don't know who that is.
Right. Yeah,
tell him my age. It's a guy. I'll put it that way. You probably thought it was a woman, but it's a man, I think.
Oh, yeah. I had no clue. Yeah, that's next step. We're going to throw you to the curb and start our new startup show, just travel specifically. All right. We're done with recruitments and all that fun stuff, at least for now. Going forward with the fun little debates we kind of picked out beforehand. So we're going to start with this upcoming team, just a couple things with them, and then, you know, more specifically dive into next year's roster. So first up, this upcoming team, they're on campus. Cal Perry said yesterday that every single player is officially on campus. They're working out, doing strength and conditioning. They're getting shots up in the Joe Kraft Center. Things are looking all fine and dandy right now. He is just about as ecstatic as you could get about a basketball team. He came out both today on KSR and yesterday hyping up this team, saying he is a great team. He's hoping that there is a basketball season because of how good this team is. So I wanted to ask, one of the biggest topics that we're still waiting on with this team is Olivier Saar and, you know, how that's going to impact this upcoming roster. He definitely had some optimistic quotes yesterday and today, I guess, on KSR both, talking about Olivier Saar's waiver request and whether or not the NCAA is going to grant that. So, Travis, I want to start with you. Cal says he feels confident. He says that Olivier has a fantastic pitch to the NCAA. Says that he thinks ultimately at the end of the day he'll be eligible. How much better does that make you feel about the whole situation and about the team next year moving forward as a whole?
I'm still definitely cautiously optimistic about it. I don't want to put the cart before the horse because it's the NCAA. But the thing is with the NCAA is they've been granting waivers like it's like everybody's getting one. Like you get a waiver, you get a waiver, you get a waiver.
Yeah. The NCAA is turning into Oprah.
It's like, yeah. But, Saar would make this team probably – I want your all's opinion on this – probably make this team the – third best team of the Cal era. That's what I've been sticking with. I've heard third. I've heard fourth. Some people say second. Some people, the overly optimistic people, say first. Every year, like it could be like 40-0 every year. But I think this team could be like let's say they play a full schedule, which I'm not banking on that either. I think this team would go like 36-4. I don't really see a weakness outside of potentially point guard.
David, what are your thoughts?
Their preseason top three. I don't know about as far as where I would rank them among other teams. I've really not thought about that. But if they get him, then they're there, you know. And I think even the naysayers, I mean, like Jeff Goodman, I think even said if they get Saar, that they're going to go, you know, much higher and up the rankings. But I think he had some skepticism on that. Let me say this first. You know, when you look at guys getting the waivers, you look at JT Daniels at Georgia, and here's the interesting thing, though. He left or declared that he entered the transfer portal, I think, on May 28th, and he's already found out where Saar was in March, And there are transfers who made who went to the transfer portal in December and still haven't found anything out yet. So there's all that just inconsistency of timing. And another thing is, I talked to a recruiting coordinator at a school yesterday, at a Power Five school, and we talked about some things, and in particularly the transfers and getting waivers. And he said, you know, that JT Daniel was a deal where I think he went to Mater Dei, and USC is going to continue to recruit that school hard. So the best thing you can have happen is for your old school to put in a good word for you to the NCAA. Yeah. And so he thought that was a reason. And he said this all along. He said, look, there are just each one is still an individual case. And having said all that, John Calipari says that he thinks they've got a really good argument. I would like to know. I'm not saying he don't. If he says that, I believe him. I would like to know what it is. He's not going closer to home. I know the coach got fired. I'm just interested to see what his case is to the NCAA.
Yeah, I mean, it's. I'd like to see the specifics of it, but when you look at, so I think Kyle Tucker put out something today where he got Danny Manning. I know that we kind of talked about that a little bit behind the scenes, was how much would Danny Manning really support, and what's his relationship right now with Calipari, and how much would he be willing to help out if the NCAA asked him for any input? Steve Forbes, same thing with him. We're seeing if he would vouch for SAR and you know, help expedite the waiver process. Seems like in both cases, Kyle Tucker interviewed both, and both of them both flat out came out and said that they would support an immediate eligibility for each of them, for SAR. So it appears that everything is working behind the scenes in SAR's favor, but the NCAA is just so wishy-washy. And Cal brought up a good point yesterday. He said Cal or the NCAA circles cases like this differently than, you know, most other ones, because this is such a high profile school and a high profile player. He said, we're going to be totally honest here. This is Kentucky, and this is Olivier Saar, who most consider to be the best transfer on the market right now. So when you have both of those things, it kind of brings up a red flag with the NCAA, and they want to double and triple check their work before making any official decision, because they know that this decision could single-handedly change the landscape of college basketball.
My argument is there a bigger, in the world of sports, is there a bigger transfer out there than quarterback leaving USC and going to Georgia? I mean, he's going to be the starting quarterback of Georgia, and they play Alabama, like, what, week three? You watch Paul Feinbaum. That's the game that everybody – that's the first game they talk about on the SEC schedule. So I'm just curious the quarterbacks. I mean, you look at Fields, man. He got cleared like that at Ohio State. Yeah. So you get quarterbacks, and, man, they get cleared like nobody's business, and mm-hmm. just very quickly. And then, you know, Saar has to wait. And I've got a fear just in the back of my mind, stored away, that what happens if it's September and he's not heard anything yet? You know, so, you know, not only do they have to rule the right way, timing may not be the issue it was when we were still waiting on our big guy out of California, McCour, but, you know, it's still an issue. If he's got the option to play internationally and make money, how long is he going to wait around after school starts if they've not made a decision? I hope they do it quickly.
Yeah, I think – I
had a question for you guys. Whose waiver do we hear about first, Joey Gatewood or Olivier Saar?
Well, I think that this week we heard that we were waiting on the SEC for Joey Gatewood's case, which is kind of shocking to me, because he was committed back in, what, January? So we're now talking about 7 months of waiting for Gatewood. You'd think that they would go to the SEC first because that's who's apparently holding this whole thing up. They'd go to the SEC first and make sure that, you know, Auburn to Kentucky, that Auburn side's okay, Kentucky side's okay, that the SEC is okay with that interconference transfer, and then go to the NCAA. And you'd think that that would be the order of operations, but it appears they went to the NCAA first. They said, well, you got to go to the SEC. And then, so if they're still waiting on the SEC before the NCAA can rule on it, I think we're going to be waiting even longer for Joey Gatewood, which is, and that's no inside information or anything. That's just reading the tea leaves. But I think there is some internal speculation that we'll hear something on Olivier Sarr soon. You think that Calipari wouldn't put himself forward on radio shows and press conferences with the media if he didn't want to answer questions about Olivier Sarr. Like if he didn't know anything, you know, about any type of positivity, getting a little bit closer on a waiver, resolution, he wouldn't go out of his way to talk to the media or, you know, talk to radio hosts and all that stuff. So with all the everything combined, it definitely appears that Olivier Sarr is going to be going first between the two, and that it's probably going to happen sooner rather than later, given how optimistic it feels Cal is and how willing he is to talk right now.
You know, and there's a thing about jumping through hoops, like you talked about with the NCAA, Vanderbilt's got, you know, a point guard that they're trying to get eligible, Isaac McBride from Kansas. And, you know, evidently there were some hoops there that they had to jump through for a couple of months and trying to figure out when he was going to get on campus. And it really wasn't anything that Jerry Stackhouse or the basketball program could do. And that's really put a delay into the NCAA make a decision. And he left Kansas last September. So, but like you say, it's the logistics of it.
Yeah. We'll see. I mean, it's a huge, huge, huge decision for all parties involved. I mean, it's, we had Jeff Goodman on this show a couple months back. He flat out said, with Olivier Sarr, this is a Final Four team. Without him, they are number 24 in the nation or whatever he has them in his current ranking. It is that much of a difference between legitimate top 10, top 5 Final Four level team and, you know, Sweet 16, Round of 32 type team. So we'll see. We'll see how it goes. It's going to be huge. So, we talked a little bit before the show. We kind of added this in at the last second. We're going to assume Olivier Sarr gets eligible. We're going to ask this question: who are going to be the top three scorers on this upcoming roster, in order from most to I guess most to third most? Travis, who do you think is going to be Kentucky's leading scorer this upcoming year, and why?
I think Terrence Clark, a lot of people say B.J. Boston will be number one. I think Terrence Clark will be number one. Love his scoring ability. Love his ability to get into the lane. Kind of reminds me of probably the best slippery paint finisher that Kentucky's had since Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. Then I'll go B.J. Boston. I think both of those guys, I think one will average like 18 points. I think one will average like 17. And then Olivier Sarr, I think, could average like 13, 14. It depends on – I think the offense can be ran a little different, but Olivier is going to really benefit from those two being absolute monsters that people are going to forget about him sometimes down low, and he's going to get so many opportunities from that dunker spot. And I think – well, I mean, you know Calipari is going to run through his big some. I want to see what the offense is going to look like this year just because it's the best weapons that he's had in a few years, but I think Olivier is definitely going to average a minimum of like 12 points a game. I think Keon Brooks is kind of a dark horse here to be third.
Yeah, that's who I was going to say is my number three guy. I'm going to go B.J. Boston number one. I think he absolutely has the makings of a 20 point per game scorer. The next Jamal Murray, Malik Monk, those, you know, that electric, you know, you can guarantee that they're going to go out there and put up 17 to 20 to 25 points per game or on any given night, rather. So I'm going to go B.J. Boston one, Terrence Clark two, and I'm going to have Keon Brooks as my third. I think I wanted to go Olivier Sarr here, but I just have this gut feeling that Keon Brooks is going to explode in his second year at Kentucky. I think Coach Cal trusts Keon Brooks so much right now that, you know, you kind of saw it at the end of the year. I think that's going to transition extremely well into this year. Some of the highlights I've seen of Keon Brooks, it looks like he's bulked up a little bit. His shot looks like it's improved. He looks more fluid. He looks more comfortable dribbling the ball. He just looks like he is poised for a breakout second year. So I'm going to go have him as my number three. David, what do you think?
BJ Boston first, and I've got to really kind of go back and forth between second and third, and here's a reason. I think maybe Talent would tell, and I shouldn't say Talent, but Terrence Clark is such a high-level player. But Olivier Saar, I mean, you look at the numbers he put up at Wake Forest, but then on top of that, is John Calipari going to have his big man who you know can score and is really cut out to play the post the way John Calipari likes it played offensively as the number three option? I mean, I can't imagine a Kentucky team with John Calipari where they're just letting it fly from the perimeter and every now and then Calipari's like, oh, man, get our big guy a touch. I mean, you know how he likes to go inside and out. So I'm back and forth between Saar and Clark, but I might go with Saar simply from the case that just from the law of percentages that he's going to get an ample amount of touches inside.
Yeah, I think that's totally fair. And I think to have four guys and, you know, maybe even more than that if you want to look further down the roster – to have four guys that you're that confident in to be a scoring threat on any given night, I mean, that's what championship teams are made of. And David, I'm digging the house tour that we're getting from you.
Well, I'm sorry. Every time I try to move, the sun is over my right shoulder right here, and it keeps – we got some steps here, and it keeps going through. It wasn't here at first. I apologize. I'm going from chair to chair, but I think we're good now.
I felt like it was in the That 70 Show basement. And we're just
It's covered. The sun covered my face up, so I expect the ratings to be a lot better.
You know? Dude, we're going to be good.
That was probably good for the show.
Hey, let me ask you, rank these three guys from top scorer to whoever scores the least. Isaiah Jackson, Devin Askew, Lance Ware.
I'm going to go Devin Askew, one, Isaiah Jackson, two, Lance Ware, three.
Ask it one more time, Travis. Let me make sure I got it right.
Leading scorer to the least amount of points out of these three, Isaiah Jackson, Devin Askew, and Lance Ware.
I'm going to say Askew, Ware, Jackson. Simply from being on the floor, I think Askew will probably be on the floor a little bit more. Going to have the ball in his hands a little bit more. I think Ware might be a little bit more polished offensively now. Isaiah Jackson, in the long run, we've talked about it. He could be tremendous before he's done. But, you know, early on, Ware might be a little ahead offensively.
I'm going to go differently from what you guys said. I think Jackson will be the leading scorer out of those. I think he'll average like 7-8 points a game. Could be the sixth man on this roster once all said and done. Come tournament time, then I'll go Askew and then I'll go Ware.
I'm going to tell you what, if you do get Saar and Isaiah Jackson averages 8 points a game because you know what he's going to give you rebounding and protecting a rim, I mean, how good could this team be?
Yeah, that – I mean
– it's kind of the high point for him. I think it would probably be more like six, but I could definitely see – I'm really bullish on Isaiah Jackson. I think that he's just so full of energy you can't keep him off the court. If he can rebound consistently like Cal wants and he can defend, I think he'll get a lot of minutes, like 20, 25 minutes a game.
How much pressure is there on Devin Askew to score? Because I know he's got around him where I wouldn't say pressure. Hey, you've got to score, but teams start playing off of it.
He
can shoot the ball, but, I mean, does he set the table? Does he have to get involved? I guess I'm asking what's his role.
I think freshman Emmanuel Quickley is who he is.
Yeah. So
how far can he go if he's freshman Emmanuel Quickley?
It depends on –
Calipari, man, he had the hook quick on Quickley and Montgomery when they were freshmen. And that's probably going to be your starting point guard.
See, that's – my thing is I don't rate how far this team can go based on Devin Askew. I think this team's going to go as far as Terrence Clark and B.J. Boston could take them. I think that as long as they get adequate point guard play, just where they don't hurt you, but they're kind of just floor generals out of both Mintz and Askew. I think that this team could do some damage. But I think that we talked about before, I think Terrence Clark is going to have a lot of ball handling duties. I think B.J. Boston is going to as well. And I think the offense, I think they'll touch the ball more than Mintz and Askew.
Talking to Devin Askew's dad, he said at Mater Dei last year, if Devin was scoring 20 points or more in any given night, Mater Dei loses more often than they don't. If he is putting up 12 to 15 points a game and putting up, you know, 12 to 15 assists per night, they won almost every single time. So when you think of what his mindset and what he favors, he doesn't want to go out there. I mean, he can shoot lights out. He can score the ball, but he prefers to be that facilitator, that, you know, have that court vision and make sure that the two stars on the team and B.J. Boston and Terrence Clark both get the ball in their hands and, more importantly, in position to score. So I think a lot of people are kind of overstating the, you know, Devin Askew's flaws and looking at, you know, the lack of dribble separation, stuff like that. I think they're focusing a little bit too much on his scoring abilities instead of what he's going to bring to the table as a passer and as a true point guard. And that's where I think he's going to thrive in year one. So I think Emmanuel Quickley was more of a pure catch and shoot guy year one. I think he's going to be more of a facilitator, but still be able to catch and shoot, you know, once or twice a game at least. So I'm not focusing on points with him. I'm focusing on you know, assists, deflections, steals, kind of an all-around game in year one for Devin Askew.
I understand how good your wings are going, how good your two and three are going to be with Boston and Clark, and you need a guy who can get them the ball where they can immediately just be in a scoring mode. I understand that. But you know what's going through my mind right now? I'm thinking, okay, what if they see that Calipari sees, hey, with this, I can't go as far as I need to go. What's the chances of a B.J. Boston going to the one? Because we know he can play some of that, that he goes to the one. You put a Dante Allen at a three, or you slide Keon Brooks back to a three, and you can play Ware or Jackson or somebody like that at the four.
I'm all for it. That is music to my ears, and I think that's music to Calipari's ears. He talks about positionless basketball and wanting to be as versatile as possible. That in itself is position that is what Calipari is trying to implement with his rosters every single year. He wants to be able to have guys that, okay, if Devin Askew's not ready for the spotlight yet, throw B.J. Boston in. If Davion Mintz isn't the high-level guy, the perfect fit, as Kentucky described him as when he first got there, you have other options to present. You know, Terrence Clark, the staff feels confident in him running the one every once in a while. B.J. Boston has, you know, when Sierra Canyon didn't have a true point guard last year, they had to run through Amari Bailey. But because of that, B.J. Boston had the ball in his hands so often and kind of – it was kind of, you know, sink or swim in terms of ball handling. He had to be that facilitator and kind of run the show a little bit. I think that took his game to another level. So when you think of all the ball handling options this team has and scoring options and so much versatility on the wing and then moving down into the front court, I mean, there are so many options that this team has to you know, be deep and talented from top to bottom. I mean, that is why I think this team could be in the upper level. Going back to Travis's question earlier about how good this team can actually be in relation to some of the other Cal teams, I think that's what separates them from some of the others in terms of being a top two, top three, top four level team.
In defense of Askew at that spot, at the point guard spot, now I really go back and kind of think about this a little bit. You know, you rarely see a John Calipari offense initiate a ball screen. You know, they're running pin downs on both sides is what we're seeing. You know, even going back to his teams in 2012, 2013, they hardly never start out in the ball screen. It was, you know, the circle action or the Iverson cuts or something. You got a pin down on one side, and then you got this guy doing the same thing. If they don't get it, they reverse. The post pops, they reverse it to him, they get a pin down on the other side, hit that other wing, they post behind it. So I think that's where he's most comfortable. So, yeah, you've got, like you say, you've got Boston working on one side and you've got Clark working on the other side where they're in your wheelhouse a little bit.
See, my thing, back to the question about if BJ or Terrence, for that matter, could play the one, I think it would make sense if they, if Mintz and Askew were struggling. I think that it could really – if that was the case, those two were struggling, I think it could raise Kentucky's ceiling in that, at that point. But I think the coaches speak of positionless basketball is kind of overhyped by some of the fan base because we have yet to see it, and like to a true point. And – everybody talks about dribble drive. There's not too many dribble drives implemented in the offense anymore. This would be the year to do it for sure. Both of those things, but
until, they've been saying that the last 2 years too.
Until I see it, and like until I see it, I'm not going to project that Clark or Boston will run the point. No matter how much I want to see it, I think it's fair to say that this team has the highest possibility of whoever gets the ball gets it and goes. And sets it up, initiates. But, I mean, like David said earlier, it's like kind of like Sar. Like, on this team, if – like, this has the perfect makeup to, like, not run through him, like, to run through the wings. But you know damn good and well that Cal's going to post. So,
yeah, that's totally fair. Until we see that day come where – they actually do implement the positionless basketball and go dribble drive the way I think Cal wants to. I think it's definitely more coach speak. I mean, I think Cal addresses the positionless stuff and wants to hype that up more than what he actually shows whenever it comes to an in-game situation. So yeah, I'm right there with you. I completely agree.
We'll see how it goes. I think in today's game, you know, when he was running dribble drive at Memphis, we hadn't seen, you know, what Steve Kerr's doing at Golden State, what Jay Wright did at Villanova with all the threes and the way they spread it out. We were still – it was still Steve Nash, Mike D'Antoni type. Ball screen, drive, you know, a kick, and they would shoot some threes. But that was revolutionary. And now the game, even in 10 years or more than 10 years, we're talking 12 from his days at Memphis, are so much different. Now, when you think positionless, you think 33s a game to spread the floor out. If you think John Calipari's beard is gray now, if he had a team that took 33s, can you imagine? I mean,
yeah.
He'd look like Lou Dolson.
Oh, okay. Well, we're going to jump into the 2021-22 roster and kind of make that the bulk of the show. But I think that's going to be more of a secondary topic for us. We'll jump into that right now. But yeah, let's do that. Let's do that right now. Looking ahead to that roster, let's kind of make some big predictions about how things unfold. I guess this kind of goes hand in hand with our previous topic of, okay, we all need to go through who stays, who goes. Are there any surprises either way? And who signs? We got to project basically the whole roster from top to bottom. And the winner will get a prize if the show's still going on by this time next year and we actually get to
I thought we agreed I was going to be fired by then.
Oh, yeah. I was more so saying I'm still going to be a part of this, but it's more if David is still going to be a part of this collective group.
And before we start, let me set the ground rules for the people on Twitter that are going to next March come at my throat whenever something on my prediction is wrong. People are still coming at me about Cade Cunningham, who at one point was coming to Kentucky for the 30th time. When he ended up not coming to Kentucky, I still get people tweeting at me about that. You're 40 years old. Get over it. Grow up. Like, there's more about people than me. Like, just chill. But, all right. Yeah, we're not going to get all these predictions right.
And by the way, whoever loses, I hope there's no nudity involved.
between that, predictions now or what?
Between that and you're doing cartwheels naked over Luka Garza, I think this is saying more about you than it's saying about us, David.
If they could get Luka Garza,
we gotta have a serious conversation with you at some point. This is getting a little out of hand. Anyway, who wants to start?
Okay, I'll be the fool here. All right. So what do you want first? Who comes back? Who leaves? What do you want?
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Davion Mintz will be gone. Sar will be gone.
I think you got that right.
Let me ask you this. And I was thinking about this the other day when we first started talking about what our topics would be. Do you think, can you see a situation where Dante Allen and Cameron Fletcher both come back? And I don't think either one of them is going to go to the NBA after 1 year, but I think, and who knows, it's Kentucky. But does somebody say, look, man, here I am. I was the third string three this year. You know, I'm just going to go somewhere else. And you're going to have the automatic transfer. Do you think they both come back?
I personally don't see it. I really don't. I mean, there's some stuff. Oh, yeah. I think of the two, Dante Allen would be the guy to stick around. Or, I mean, yeah, I think he'd be the guy to stick around if there was one, you know. But, man, yeah, that's tough. That is really, really tough.
I'm going to go with Allen. Then I'm going to guess then Boston's gone. Obviously, Clark's gone. I think Hardy comes back. Ware and Jackson.
Who's Hardy?
I said Hardy. I'm sorry. God, Devin asked you. I'm sorry. I was going down to roster, and I had recruits. I looked at Jaden Hardy. I had Las Vegas on my mind. Boston. So Fletcher and Jackson. Obviously, Topin will be he'll be able to go. I don't know that I see a situation, and maybe that's why they're not recruiting Post, because I remember asking, you know, Travis, just what about the lack of 21s? Just trying to bounce it off him. The offer's there, and he said, I just think the coaching staff thinks that they're going to have people back. So, Jackson.
How'd that work with Johnny Juzang and Khalil Whitney, both guys who they expected to be back this year?
Okay, so can we see Jackson, Ware, and Topin, all three, on the team in 2 years, kind of playing that four spot?
They're on mine, yeah.
And who knows? And then, it's tough. You know, and then you got the thing of Keon Brooks. I mean, I know it's a unicorn. A guy stays to his junior year. But, will Keon Brooks make the improvement to where he's going to get drafted? You know,
it's your guessing game, not mine.
Some other guys, he didn't stop E.J. Montgomery. So, man, that's tough. I think one of your fours are not going to be back. I think that Cameron Fletcher is not going to be back. And I just go back and forth so much. You will probably wonder, why are you just back and forth? You don't know who it's going to be, man. That's a tough call. I don't know which four, but I'm going to say one of those three guys is not going to be back. It's either going to be Ware or just one of those guys, either Ware or Jackson's not going to be back.
Okay. Travis, what do you think?
Are we just doing attorneys or recruits or both?
Just start with just attorneys and who's leaving.
All right, I think Mintz is gone, Sar's gone, Boston's gone, Clark's gone, Brooks is gone. My thing is, looking at what I project the 2021-22 roster to be like
Will Keon Brooks get drafted?
I think if he can hit threes at a 35% to 40% clip, that he will that he could be a high second round draft pick.
Okay.
I think he could be a small ball four. I think
you're saying high second round. You're not saying his back door.
Huh? No, I'm saying that I think that's his ceiling is a high second round pick. I don't think he's a first round pick. But that's if everything goes well. But I think he'll be gone regardless. I'm just guessing. But I think Topin would return. And like you said, I don't know where to go with the fours because I think Kentucky is in good shape with two bigs in the class. And I mean, are there Topin's probably gonna play a small ball four? Fletcher's a small ball four. Jackson is a four. Ware's a four. I think one of Ware and Jackson might be gone. Like, not the NBA. I think they might transfer.
You know, Jackson's more of your five. I think if there's a player in that group that we think can play the five, it's him. And you're talking about your 21s, and we won't spoil it. We kind of all kind of know who that is that are coming in. They're both more of the four. So yeah. maybe of that group, maybe, and I don't know, but maybe just because position wears odd man out.
See, my thing is I'll be more liable to say that these players transfer because we expect it to happen if and when the immediate transfer rules pass next year. I could see a guy like Lance Ware or whoever gets the shorter end of the stick between Jackson and Ware. I could see Fletcher or Allen transferring. But if I had to pick right now, I think that this is impossible at Kentucky. It is impossible.
Yeah. This is the dumbest thing we've ever done.
Can I ask one more question?
I got a better chance of hitting the damn lottery.
Can I ask one more question? That'll give you a little bit more time to think but I like to ask you, there's so many ways to go and play devil's advocate. Would you rather have a sophomore Ware and Jackson or a freshman Bancaro and Huntley Hatfield? I've got a feeling I know which way you're going to go, but
I know I'm going to go with Jackson and Ware just because.
Really?
Yeah.
I would have lost the bet on that one.
Here's my thing with that. Because a lot of people, I mean, I could totally see how somebody would say Paulo and Brandon on this, but I'll go with Jackson and Ware just because they'll have a year in the system. I think that Jackson, we talked about him possibly being a lottery pick after a second year. I'm not like, I think Brandon and Huntley Hatfield's good, but I've got a lot of questions about how his motor is. So for as good as Paulo could be, you get two really solid guys in Ware and Jackson. You get one star in Paulo. Jackson could be a star. But then you got one question mark with me, with Brandon. I think Brandon might take some time at the college level. So what do you think, Jack?
All right, we're going to go Mintzar gone. Boston Clark gone, obviously. I agree. I think Keon's gone. I think he's going to have a big year. I think he might have end of first round potential if he is able to show off a little bit more in terms of ball handling and passing and you know, some of those type of skill sets. I think that's going to be kind of what separates him. I'm still wondering what his role is going to be, if he's going to be better as a, you know, primarily at the three or four. I think UK is going to use him at the four more so, but that's going to be one thing that I'm going to be watching closely for. But as of right now, I still think he ends up leaving. I think Fletcher will be the one to transfer out of Allen, because out of the two between him and Dante Allen, more so because I heard from somebody close to Kentucky that their UK is planning on using Cameron Fletcher as a small ball four. So when you're starting to look at all of the fours that this roster could potentially have next year, I just think it's going to get way too crowded at that position. And I mean, maybe they switch them back to the three, but they're you know, as the way things are looking right now, they're going to be deep at that position too. I just think there's going to be an odd man out, and judging by these last couple of years, those type of guys end up being the ones that transfer out. So I'm gonna just guess. I hope he doesn't, but I'm gonna guess that Fletcher's the guy transfers out. And it'll be Askew, Ware, Jackson, and Toppin all back. I think that's gonna be the four guys that return.
What do you think of David's question of which one would you rather have between Paulo and Brandon or Isaiah and Lance?
I would say Paulo and Brandon because I am so high on Paulo's game. I think he is an instant starter, instant star at the college level. I think he's truly an 18 and 12 guy at the college level from day one. I am that high on his game. I think he is so polished for his size, he's so skilled, you know, great college ready, NBA ready size from day one. I genuinely think he could be a PJ Washington from day one. I really do. I am extremely. I think he should be the number one player in the class of 2021. So,
Let me ask you this. Let's take Bancaro out of it. So, remember Huntley Hatfield. If he does if he is there in 2 years, he's had to reclass and move up. So we're basically talking a guy who would be a high school senior. So we're talking 20-year-old Ware, 20-year-old Jackson, 18-year-old Huntley Hatfield, if, which two of three out of that group? Two of the three. You've got two 20-year-olds and you've got an 18-year-old Huntley Hatfield.
Oh, I'm taking the two near guarantees with two near guarantees with Lance Ware and Isaiah Jackson. I just think if you're giving me any scenario that has Paolo Banchero in it, I'm going to take that scenario. Right. I don't care what it is. It could be Frank Anselm is the second guy in that. I'm taking Paolo and Frank.
So here's my thinking is I don't think Isaiah or Ware will be as good. I think Isaiah might have the highest pro ceiling out of all of them, honestly. I think Paolo's probably the highest ceiling. I wouldn't even argue against it. College big. I think he would be UK's best big last year. My thing is, you get two consistent guys. Say one of those is the sixth man, and let's say Paolo gets in foul trouble. Then you're depending on Brandon Huntley Hatfield, who I said I have questions about. He could be a superstar. That's the thing. Like, it all depends on his motor and how he develops over the past couple of years, what kind of player he wants to be, because he floats out on the perimeter way too much for me right now.
If he gets inside and throws elbows and gets nasty,
but you can't just change the kid. Like, that's the thing too. Like, I want to see him do that one time, because if I see him do that and just dominate and have like 30 points and 20 rebounds in a game at the high school level, I'll be like, all right, damn, let's go. But I mean, we've seen it time and time again. We wanted Alex Poitras to be like that. You're never going to change his mentality. That's just who he is.
I know.
A lot of kids nowadays, you're just not going to change their mental makeup. But I think that, like you said, let's say Paolo's an 18-12 guy, and then let's say Brandon's like a 6 or 7 and 4 guy. Then you get Isaiah and Lance that could be like 12 and 8 apiece. I mean, yeah. I'm taking. I mean, I don't think there's a wrong answer either way, but I'm going to take the probably the higher floor of the two.
Okay. All right, we'll do who signs of this class. Who does Kentucky sign in the class of 2021? David, we'll start with you.
Man, I like asking the questions. That's a lot more funner than answering. A lot more. Okay, I think right now – in the near future, I think we're probably pretty clear, all of us, that we may be off one guy or so, but I think there's kind of a beat on it who the favorites are. I think, obviously, Sky Clark.
Do you want to go from most confident to least confident?
Okay. I'm going to go – okay. I think Scott Clark, I'm the most confident of him signing, but he's still 2022. So I'm going to put Jaden Hardy first because he's a 21. And then my second one is going to be Scott Clark as a signing and then reclassing to the 21. That's my second one. Huntley Hatfield doing the same. Number three, Banchero, number four. And that doesn't mean that I think they're a long shot for Banchero. I think Kentucky's the favorite. You know, you hear a lot about Tennessee, but I've started hearing some other places a little bit more the last few days, maybe a Duke and a Washington. And I know we think Kennedy Chandler's going to go to Tennessee, and they've talked about playing together, but a lot of times that doesn't work out. I just wonder if Banchero, like I said, well, to Tennessee, it just seems I'm hearing less and less buzz around that. And maybe that's not the case, but I still think they're going to get him. And so that's where we were talking about the four being stacked. Now, we go to some of the other spots, and Travis, I think you've got a better idea than I do on Bradley. And I was thinking about, well, all the guards, we think Askew's going to be back, and then you get Hardy, and then you've got Sky Clark, and then you've got Bradley. But then again, you've got all of those fours and that's what we talked about. Then if you get Bancaro and Huntley Hatfield coming in on top of it, it seems like you're really top heavy at the one, at the two, maybe not so much at the three. That kind of plays itself out. Isaiah Jackson could be solid at the five. You don't have depth, but it looks like those spots right there, you're kind of top heavy.
Travis?
I think I'll go with most confident. I'll swap your top two. I think I'm super, super, super confident in Sky Clark being at Kentucky. Right. The only thing, like, I don't even think that another school will keep him from going to Kentucky. I think it'll be just the reclassification. So I think I'll put him at one, Hardy at two.
Let me ask you this. You're 100-0 Sky Clark. Let's say 100%. What's your confidence in reclassing? 80, 90? Is that too much?
I'll say
75.
I'll play it 70, 75. I'll play it safe. I mean, I'm confident. Kentucky thinks he can play at the college level right now. So if his development keeps on trending up, and he's got great trainers down there in Tennessee that he's working with, if his development keeps up, I think he'll definitely reclass. And so we got him at one, got Clark at one, Hardy at two. I don't think Jaden Bradley will reclass as of today. I don't think he will. And if he does, I don't know if it'll be Kentucky. UK still in the thick of things. I'm just trying to crunch the numbers here. I'm going to leave him out of this one. I'll put Brandon Huntley Hatfield at three. So that's Clark, Hardy, Brandon Huntley Hatfield. Then I'll put Paulo at four. And I'll say they get a grad transfer or like a random surprise reclass on down the road.
And remember, you've got open. You're pretty well going for sure to have an open transfers, automatic transfers next year.
Yeah, I think they'll definitely open. Like, I think they'll add, depending on roster attrition, which we can't. I mean, we did predict it, but we can't thoroughly predict it until probably 9 months from now. So,
but if Jaden Bradley does stage 22, doesn't that kind of set up? I would think Devin asked you. You're looking at 2 years. And then Sky could be a one-and-done possibility. Does that just kind of set up for Bradley just to step right in that 22 class and, boom, he's your point guard?
Yeah, I definitely think as of right now that he is Kentucky's man for the 2022 class. I think that they would welcome him as a 2021 as well. And like Jack said on here before, like just add whoever wants to come, whoever wants to smoke can get the smoke. So –
That was the exact quote I got. I said, yeah. So give me a scenario that Jaden Bradley, Sky Clark all want to come with Jaden Hardy and
you said Kennedy Chandler too at that time.
I think so. And then Devin asked you, and they basically said, whoever wants a smoke, come get the smoke. It's like, oh, all righty then. It's pretty badass. I like that a lot.
But I don't see Kennedy Chandler being at Kentucky at all. I put in a future cast for him. I was first in March for Tennessee, and I've been confident in him going to Tennessee since like last November, December, after talking to some people close to him. But his relationship with Kim English at Tennessee is just winning out there, and I think he'll be a great guard, and they'll be a thorn in Kentucky's side for years to come. And speaking of Kim English, that's the guy that if Paulo lands at Tennessee, like Kim English is going to be in line for a top college basketball job here soon, because he is phenomenal at building relationships with these kids.
He might get one anyway, because you talk in recruiting circles and the various, you know, assistants everywhere. Like, he is the guy that people are like, that's the name to watch out for. Like, that's the guy that everybody in coaching circles think is going to be the next big guy.
Like, his charisma, everybody that I talk to says that they either look at him like a big brother or a father figure, or just somebody that he relates so well to these kids and puts them first and their needs. So,
yeah,
I don't think he'll be at Tennessee much longer.
Yeah, me, I agree. I'll go through my list quickly. I'm going to go Sky Clark one. I'm going to go Brandon Huntley Hatfield two. I'm going to go with the two reclass guys as the my top guys. I'm going to go Jaden Hardy three, just because I am slightly worried, or at least keeping an eye on the G League for Hardy. And then And then I'll go Paolo is four. And I think from there, I mean, you look at that roster from top to bottom. If the, what I was saying, if things unfold that way, it'd be Askew, Hardy, Sky Clark, Brandon Huntley Hatfield, Paolo, Lance Ware, Isaiah Jackson, Jacob Toppin. And I think there's a grad transfer they already have a close eye on that I think things are already working behind the scenes that he, odds are looking pretty solid that unfolds. So they're already, that'd be nine guys on the roster as of right now. And when this open transfer rule happens, you can pretty much guarantee that they're going to get at least one kind of star talent on the transfer market. So putting all that stuff combined, I mean, that's going to be a talented, talented roster from top to bottom if it unfolds the way it's kind of looking to be.
I can't imagine when the transfer rule comes out there that it's just not like a draft for Kentucky. Yeah. That you've got some guy who's been somewhere, he just come off a 20-point a game season, and, hey, I want to play at Kentucky. I just can't imagine that not being the case. I'm really kind of giddy to see who they can land. I mean, I think it's going to be a household name.
I hope they don't win Garza so I don't have to see you naked.
Garza will be the pros by then.
Thank God. Okay, let's close out the show.
Hey, that's a good Luke. Would you rather. Would you rather never see David naked or would you rather land Luke Garza?
I'm taking the former on that.
Garza will be seeing naked people here in about 2 years. It won't be me.
Thank the Lord. Okay. Yeah. We're gonna end it by talking about Sam Bacini and his athletic article that went nuts. Just today, and you know, Coach Cal talked about it. Joel Justice tweeted about it. I mean, it went nuts from all day long. So he polled, I think, seven head coaches or assistant coaches at the college level about what he thinks of Kentucky's upcoming draft eligible players, from Tyrese Maxey, Emmanuel Quickley, Ashton Hagans, EJ Montgomery, and Nick Richards. And it was not good. I mean, from top to bottom, I think, you know, every single player had some negative comment toward them. Even Tyrese Maxey, who's a lottery pick, you know, not consensus. There's some people that think he'll be right on the fringe of that, but he is on the fringe of being a consensus lottery pick. And people were going, yeah, I don't see what other people are seeing in Tyrese Maxey. I think he's overrated. People talking about Emmanuel Quickley. Oh, I think a lot of his stuff was fake. I think all he did was, you know, fake out refs and got some bailout threes. I think his SEC Player of the Year reign, I think that was overrated, went through. I mean, every single player they kind of trashed on. And then the biggest one was one of them called Ashton Hagans trash. I mean, literally flat out said, I think he's a trash player. So, they, you know, they went out guns a-blazing, and UK responded and said, I hate that there are anonymous coaches that want to put kids down and all that. I mean, it was just not a good look at all. I want to know your guys' thoughts on it. Was it an overreaction from the fan base, or do you think it's, you know, unfair criticism?
I'll say this.
I think that my bad. My internet was messing up.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
All right, I'll go. Beauty before age. But looking at the grand scheme of things, I think – that, I mean, there was a couple Bush League comments, like the trash comment was unnecessary, especially by a player that Kentucky – or by a coach that Kentucky probably, I guaranteed, beat throughout the season. And so I think that was a little Bush League. There's a couple other comments that were kind of iffy. But in the grand scheme of things, I didn't have much of a problem with it because it was kind of in line with what mock drafts were saying, kind of in line with my thinking. Only one is like – Nick Richards, I've tried to kind of advocate for him to be a like early second round pick because I think he has a role in the NBA if he can work on some things. But the things that are worrying people are definitely valid points with him. EJ Montgomery, that's I agree with most of everything they're saying. He wasn't a threat all year. Never knew he was out on the court 9 times out of 10. So didn't have a problem with that. Tyrese Maxey, people were talking about how they don't know if he's going to be a true NBA how he's going to do in the NBA. And I've talked to a lot of people like that do scouting, and they think the same thing because, I mean, look at the numbers. He shot – he came in as a shooter. I think the AAU comment that they talked about, like AAU hyping him up, was very valid because AAU circuit, he blew up and he was known as this three-level scorer, lockdown defender, all that. And then he comes to Kentucky, shoots a lower percentage from the outside than Hamidou Diallo did. And he kind of shot from his belly button, it seemed like. He's got like a weird windup, which, I mean, they'll fix that in the NBA, but it's going to take some time. Thing I like about him at the next level, though, is his float game, his mid-range game, once he gets in the paint, crafty scoring. I think the NBA spacing is going to help him. Manuel Quickley, I mean, their criticisms are pretty fair, too. He had a phenomenal college season, but, like, here's the thing. Like, when we're – Sam Vecenie's talking about as a pro prospect. He's, like, Vernon Carey, fantastic college player.
Mm-hmm.
Terrible, like, mediocre – I'm not going to say terrible, but a mediocre fringe first-round guy fringe first round draft pick. Valid concerns there, but it's like with Emmanuel Quickley, the thing is, you know, you're gonna get shooting. If he can hit corner threes and play defense and handle the ball a little bit, I don't even know if he'll be a secondary ball handler, honestly. But he might play. I think a good fit for him would be a team that has a point guard and then a 3 and D or an initiating three. Small forward of some sort that, or like a James Harden. I think he'd be a good fit for, I think he'd be perfect in Philadelphia with Ben Simmons running the point, and then you got point forward, and then you got Shake Milton. And then they need shooting anyway. I would love to see him go there, but outside of shooting, he's not guaranteed to give you too much. Who am I missing? There's somebody else.
Richards.
Oh, yeah, I talked about Richards. I talked about him. I feel like I'm missing somebody.
EJ,
no,
I'm just Ashton.
Ashton, well, yeah,
that's a big one. He's trash.
That's the one, everybody went in on him. Ashton gets it a bad rap from everybody. UK fans were hating on him this year, and the way that they were hating on him, you'd think that opposing fans would like him because he was playing so bad, but opposing coaches because that probably set them up to win. But I mean. He, like, first half of the year, I never thought he was going to be a NBA prospect because he can't shoot. He never going to be able to shoot. He's got too much of a funky shot, in my opinion. But I thought that the comment about his defense kind of being fool's gold is right on cue. Because if he doesn't get to steal and he gambles, he puts the defense in a bad spot. He's not a Trey Jones. He's not a Patrick Beverly. He's a hit-and-miss defender, and he's not going to guard any of the premier NBA point guards.
Yeah.
And I just don't see a role for him. I think he'll be an overseas player. I think he'll be in the G League for a couple years, and I think he'll be overseas.
Yeah. David, what do you think of the criticisms? Do you think they were fair, or do you think fans have reason to be upset?
First thing, I think you've got to go back and look at your audience. Like you said, who's going to be upset about it? Who's not going to be upset? If you would have asked me, if we would have had this topic last year, you would have asked me about players out of University of Tennessee, and I'm like you, Jack, I like Celtics. And, man, I was geeked after the first draft pick last year. I thought they might, add another player besides Grant Williams with that second pick. And if you would have asked me my opinion of his ability to play in the NBA, it would have been a lot more well received in Lexington. It would have been Knoxville.
Yeah, and, that's true.
I thought he was a really good college player. But I think, like I say, you have to understand the audience. If you're talking about, well, what do you think of these players as college players? What do you think about them at Kentucky? That's one thing I think that you're asking, like Travis said, what about them as NBA players, as pro players, and people gave opinions. And there's one thing that I've learned. When you talk to coaches and say, hey, this is off the record, I'll never say a word about it, breathe a word about it. And I'm sure that we know. He went to the coaches and said, look, this is going to be anonymous. You're coach number two. You're coach number four. Man, they're coaches like to – they're going to talk. It's really surprising how much they talk. And, you know, last summer, for example, Ashton was coming back. I talked to a coach that they played against the NCAA tournament the year before and said, what do you think about Ashton? And he, like I said, there were no trash comments. And I think when you get to that, that's over the top a little bit and you don't insult players. You know, he just told me, hey, this is how we guarded him. This is what we thought he could do. This is what we thought they couldn't do. One thing about the college coaching fraternity, too, they talk, and it's unbelievable how much a coach on a West Coast will know about a player that plays in the Big East, or the coach in the SEC will know about a player that plays in the Big 12. I mean, it's a fraternity, and all they do is talk basketball. So they know about recruits. They know about players. So that's one thing with it also. Now, I will say this, what Seth Greenberg said, with the exception of Auburn, and I think Tennessee, they blew a 17-point lead, and I just think that game was a total fluke. And anyway, I don't think Rick Barnes would trash other people's players. Rick Bird wouldn't either. And we know John Calipari doesn't. There's one thing I like about John Calipari. He seems like every player, he's on their side. You know, he wants to see players do well. So, like I said, I don't like the trash statement. Don't know who said it. But with exception of Auburn, this team that had non-players curb stomped everybody else in the SEC. I mean, they went on a run, man. And yeah. I was really looking forward to seeing Kentucky-Auburn round three in the SEC tournament. So what's that say about your team if you're talking about some of these other guys and they're putting a beat down on you the way they did?
That is my argument. Like that, my only thing with it, I think most of the criticism is fair. I think, you know, I don't think Nick Richards projects as a superstar in the NBA, but I think some of the criticisms of, or, you know, I guess slight praise of him being a long-term role player and, you know, most of the things were true. What rubbed me the wrong way was that it kind of came off as sour grapes of, well, Nick Richards, I think he has weak legs. If he wasn't able to back down our players, how is he going to back down NBA guys? Like it would almost be backhanded compliments in a sense of, I don't even know if it's a compliment. It's hard to explain, but they would kind of throw jabs at their play this season and use it as this is why he's going to be a failure in the NBA whenever it gets to that point. It definitely rubbed me the wrong way. I mean, especially the trash comment. I'm like, dude, if you're going to call a dude trash, you have to at least put your name behind it. I mean, I thought that was kind of bush league, but it was definitely a sense of, if you're not going to be able to beat them on the court, don't say, I don't see it with, I think Tyrese Maxey is overrated. I think this guy, there were some of them, it was like every time Tyrese Maxey stepped on the floor, he never scared me. And it's like, well, could you beat him? What about the other players that you're saying that weren't as good as you expected and all that? I just think that none of the comments made a whole lot of sense in terms of representing the currents, the this past season and how they played against them. If you want to talk purely as a draft prospect, that's totally fine. I just don't know how you can say, oh, this guy sucks, this guy's trash, this guy isn't what he's cracked up to be, knowing that 9 times out of 10 they beat you this past season. That was my only gripe about it. If you can't beat them on the court, don't say this kid sucks, he's not all that. Like, say I just don't know how he'll project long term at the pro level. That's my only gripe with the whole thing.
Man, it seems like all the important news is happening while we're recording this. Jonathan Kuminga is going to the G League. Terry Wilson just cut his dreads.
I mean, yeah. Sheesh. Yeah, I think that's more indicative of us lasting too long on our show than anything. Anyway. Is there anything else we want to get to?
Mike Miller got named high school coach at Houston High School. How about that?
Yeah, we'll see how long he lasts there. That is a short-term move for a long-term play. He's gonna be at a high-profile coaching job, either at the college level or in the NBA or the yeah, in the NBA. We'll see how that goes. Oh, well, is there anything else we want to get to before we call it a show?
I'm looking through Twitter right now.
Okay. Well, there are a couple questions we got from listeners. We'll go through real quick. Don't have to dwell on it, just real quickly. Who has a head coach opening first between Kentucky, Duke, and UNC? Travis, what do you think?
I'll go Duke. Between Coach K's old age, his back problems, paying Zion, something's bound to go wrong there in the near future. But in all seriousness, I think it'll be him or Roy Williams, just because they seem to be in the worst shape out of the three.
That's true. David, what do you think?
The thing about Roy Williams, it scares me from how quickly he went from good health to looking like he's got one foot in the grave and one on a banana peel. When you get my age, you start worrying about stuff. But I know Coach K is older than Roy, but man, Roy's, when you watch him walk and all the conditions he's had, he had the vertigo, and I think he had a cancer scare, and man, and I know Coach K's had the back, but listen, Zion, they can bring in the Watergate attorneys, and
yeah.
Duke's not going to get stuck with anything, so I don't think he's worried about that. I think they're not going to kill the goose, lay the golden egg. So I'm going to say that Roy goes first.
Okay. I'm going to go Coach K. I just think playing the odds here, I think Coach K has been around for forever. If we're just playing the odds, he'll be the first out.
I think Coach K will be at Lexington another 10 years.
I don't know about all that. Maybe. Okay, who will be the first commitment in the class of 2021 for Kentucky? David.
Who did I say the other time? Jay. Who did I say the other time?
I think you said Jay.
I think you said Jaden Hardy.
I think you guys are listening, Jaden Hardy.
Yeah, I think – I mean, 2021, I think that's probably the safest bet if you wanted to put your money on something.
Yeah. I think it's going to be Sky. I think it's going to be Sky at some point in the fall. I think it'll be Brandon Huntley Hatfield in January, and then Jaden at some point early, not long after that. I think those can be the first two. Paolo said that he's going to announce in November, I think. So
the other time, and I really didn't pay attention to that. We said most likely because there was the reclass. First one, I'm going to go with Sky. First one.
Yeah,
he'll be the first commit.
If we're counting, like, I thought we were just going 2021. If we're counting both classes, I'll go Sky as well.
Okay, that's fair. What's the latest with Kentucky's chances with Peyton Watson? Travis, what do you think with that?
I talked to his dad. His dad actually called me while I was on vacation, talked to me for like an hour and a half. UK is very interested, wants to see him in person. Same thing there, kind of in a holding pattern. If UK gets involved, they're going to be a threat. Not going to say it's going to be a runaway because the West Coast teams are really pulling hard for his services, but I think that UK is the only one that could possibly get him off the West Coast. Maybe Michigan, but, I mean, as right now, it probably looks like a USC, UCLA, Arizona type of deal.
David, what do you think?
And the only thing I would add to that, it would make sense if they do get involved. Because, a big wing is really not what they've looked at in the 2021 class. He certainly fits that bill and has been a fan of the Kentucky program, but Travis knows this one as good as anybody, and it looks like they're not going to wait around forever waiting for Kentucky to step up.
Yeah, we'll see. I'll say West Coast as of right now, unless Kentucky gets serious in the next several weeks. I think it's a week thing, not month thing. I think they need to jump on it if they're going to. Okay, last question. We'll call it a show. If UK could only get one between Paolo and Jaden Hardy, who would that be? We kind of touched on it earlier, but official answers here. David.
Man, that's tough. And here's the thing, they're stacked at each position. It's not like it's a need, but it's not a need because they've got other guys. Man, I've watched Jaden Hardy. We did a film breakdown, a scouting report, Travis and I did, and I watched two games, and I was so impressed with just his – man, he looked like a Gilbert Arenas at times.
Yeah.
God, just fill it up. And Banchero was such – he's so good at the four. Man, that's so tough. I think – God, you can't go wrong either way. I'm going to go with Banchero, I guess. I love to have him, and I'll be honest with you. When we talked about it before, I don't even remember who I said. But, man, I could flip a quarter. But I guess I'm going to go with Banchero. I'd like to see Jaden Hardy a little bit more committed on the defensive end. You know, Banchero really doesn't have any flaws to his game. And I think it's easier to get guards than it is bigs, even though they are stacked at that spot. So that's not really a good reason either. But Banchero evidently is just a special player.
Okay.
Go ahead, Dak.
Oh, I'm going Paolo for sure. You guys know how much I love his game. It took one game for me to watch him at Peach Jam last year. I think actually a couple of EYBL games before that, but Peach Jam for sure was just a game changer for me, seeing him go up and just dominate every time he stepped on the floor and just seeing how fluid he was and how – I mean, I remember he did something, might have been a putback, or I think it – I don't even remember what the move was, but he did something, and I looked over, and it was actually Jeff Capel standing next to me, and we both locked eyes, and it was one of those like, oh, hot damn, that's a college superstar right there. And that was the moment for me where I was like, Paolo is going to be a superstar no matter where he goes, no matter what class he's in. If he reclasses, if he doesn't, that's a superstar at the next level. He's a guarantee for me. I'm going Paolo. Travis, end us here.
I mean, like David said, flip a coin. But just for sake of argument, I'll go Paolo is probably my number one player in the class if I was doing the rankings. But I'm going to go – I'll say Jaden Hardy just to change things up here a little bit. You're talking about a guy that as soon as he crosses half court is a threat to throwing the goal. Like, straight up, like 35 feet and in, he can hit it consistently. Just shy of 40% from three last year on a lot of shots. Averaged 30.4 points, 9.1 rebounds, and 8.4 assists as a junior, and playing a lot of people on a national schedule. I would say that he might be the best scorer that Cal Perry's ever landed if he comes to Kentucky. He's going to be in that conversation. And, I mean, he's had some damn good ones. But at Kentucky, I mean, he's definitely up there with the Jamal Murrays, the Malik Monks. I think he's better than – I think long-term, I think he's better than both. But – I've seen comparisons to Brad Beal. I've seen comparisons to college Ray Allen or young Bucks Ray Allen. And people forget how good he was. It's like Hardy's athletic. He's crafty around in the paint, around the rim. He can obviously shoot, but I mean, he's an underrated passer, rebounds well for his position, over 9 rebounds a game, aggressive. So, I mean, either one, like you guys said, but I'll go Jaden. Like we talked about earlier, you got all the fours. So
after watching, you know, those game films, the thing I noticed, Jaden yet is seeing one-on-one defensive coverage. Yeah. I mean, he's double-teamed, triple-teamed all over the floor. In both games that I saw, the teams, Cathedral Catholic out of San Diego and Bishop Gorman, they did the same thing. They zone pressed, trapped in a half court, and they basically doubled in well off the ball as soon as he got it, and he gives the ball up and he never gets it back. Their ball screen, they really just off the ball screen. He got jumped and trapped off every ball screen. So And I'm just saying, God, why did he keep running it? They're just going to trap him and he's going to get it out of his hands. Go one-on-one and clear him out. But even when you did that, both teams will just do a run and jump or call a hot number, and the next guy comes and doubles him. So, I mean, he's just had the whole team chased him all over the floor. So you put him at a place like Kentucky where there's other really good players and he's not going to see double teams. I don't know what anybody in the country can check him.
Yeah. Yeah, that's about as tough as a question as you can get. I mean, you really can't go wrong with either of them. I'm hopeful that Kentucky lands both because I think they're both top three, top four players in the class. I mean, that's just two superstar-level talents for sure. All right, we're way over on time, so we'll call it a show there. David, where can fans find your work?
Cats Illustrated, along with Travis and Coach David Sisk on Twitter. And I'm glad you didn't ask the question, who would I rather have, Travis Graff or Jack Pilgrim? Because I'm not answering that.
I'll answer it for you. You would have picked Travis, of course. One overall prospect in the class of 1994. But you can find me on Twitter at TravGraff_Rivals, or you can find me on Cats Illustrated alongside David Sisk.
You can find me on Twitter at JackPilgrimKSR. You can reach out to me via email at JPilgrim@KentuckySportsRadio.com. And with that, we'll be back next week for another jam-packed Sources Say podcast. We will see you then.